Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about halohydrins.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So one addition reaction that we've learned is dihalogenation. And we saw how we can do an anti-addition where we put two halogens, like two bromines, onto an alkene. And they will add in anti-fashion. And so let's look at a slight modification of this. Let's say we've got this alkene, and now we're looking at this alkene edge on just for clarity of stereochemistry. And let's say that we've got bromine. So we've got bromine. Let's go ahead and do the first step just like it was dihalogenation. So we know that this pi bond can interact with bromine in such a way that one of these bromine atoms will now be on the molecule. We'll kick that off there. And we'll make this bromonium ion intermediate. So this is no different than dihalogenation. It's the same first step. Now, the key difference here is that we're running this not in in aprotic, right, nonpolar aprotic solution. We're running this in water. So if we're going to run this in water, the second step is actually going to go a little bit of a different way. So we know that when we do dihalogenation, what was going to happen next is that the bromide ion that we generated right here was going to go ahead and do SN2, pop open the bromonium ion, and we were going to get our dihalogenated product. But the thing is, if we're running this in water, if we're running this in aqueous conditions, it is always the case that if a molecule of solvent is able to do chemistry, that is going to do chemistry far before any other any kind of reagent in solution, because there's so much more solvent. So just kinetically speaking, if we have water floating around, water is going to go ahead and react and do SN2, because this bromonium ion intermediate is quite reactive, right? This bromine doesn't really like to have a plus charge, so whatever's around in solution, if it can do something, it's going to do it. So let's have water go ahead and attack. Water is going to do SN2 just the way the bromide ion would have if we were in inert solvent. And so water's going to pop that open. I've omitted the deprotonation step. We know that this would have OH2+. Something would grab the proton. We just saved a step. But we've got this here. And this is a halohydrin. Right, so what is a halohydrin? Well, the name kind of speaks for itself. We've got a halogen and we've got a hydroxyl, and they are on adjacent carbons. So a halogen and a hydroxyl, when they're on adjacent carbons, that is a functional group called a halohydrin. And so this is the way that we're going to make a halohydrin. Once again, it is pretty much the same thing as dihalogenation. Just pay attention that we are running this in aqueous conditions. And so before bromide that we have generated has a chance to go and do the SN2, in fact, water is going to go and do that first, because there's just so much water lying around. It's aqueous solvent, right? We've got a molecule of solvent that's going to do it. So before we check out some other things about halohydrin formation, let's just look at one thing that halohydrins can do. And so let's say we have this cyclic halohydrin, and we have the halogen and the hydroxyl trans to one another on the ring. So we've got the dash and the wedge. If we put this in aqueous base, so hydroxide, let's say, what this can do is this can actually grab this proton right here, and then these electrons can go ahead and do an SN2 and kick off that bromine, and we're going to get an epoxide. So we do want to be aware that this is one thing that halohydrins can do. But the thing is this: in order for this oxygen atom to behave as a nucleophile and displace this bromine, we must have these groups trans to one another. Okay, so on a linear molecule, they're going to be able to rotate and find the right orientation. But on a cyclic molecule like this, this must be the orientation. And the reason is that this is an SN2 reaction. Right? This is an SN2, just like any other. We know that SN2 must proceed via a backside attack. And so this bromine projecting that way, hydroxyl up this way, that is in the correct orientation for this oxygen atom to be able to access the LUMO and go ahead and do the SN2. So we will get the epoxide. On the other hand, over here, if we have the cis halohydrin, so we do have the bromine and the hydroxyl on the same side of the molecule, if we use the exact same conditions, we're not going to get the epoxide. Because the thing is that the hydroxyl is sticking out this way. It is not going to be able to come from behind and attack this this carbon in the correct orientation. And so this is actually not going to react. We'll not get the epoxide. So that's the definition of a halohydrin. That is the mechanism to get a halohydrin and one thing that a halohydrin can do. Before we move on, there's actually one more thing to discuss regarding halohydrin formation. There's actually some regiochemistry that we want to be aware of. And so that's going to go like this. We know if we have this molecule right here, we've got this alkene. Let's say we just do a regular dihalogenation. Remember, this is going to be a regular dihalogenation because of this inert solvent, right? CCl4 or something similar is not going to interfere with the reaction, right? We're going to be able to get our dihalogenated product. Solvent molecules will not interfere. And so we are going to get actually a mixture, right? Because we know that it's going to be anti-addition. So we know that the bromines are going to be trans to one another on the product. So we could get this, but we also could get the other situation, right? We could have this methyl on the wedge now, and we could have this bromine going back and then this bromine on the wedge over here. So not to confuse that, let's just put that right there. So these are the two, we're going to get a mixture of these two stereoisomers. It is an anti-addition, so the bromines are trans to one another in either case. And so that's just a regular dihalogenation. But now, remember what we said, if we do this but we run this in aqueous conditions, we're going to get our halohydrin. But let's take a look at one very important thing. Let's take a look at the bromonium intermediate now, right? If we're going to look at things mechanistically, let's say we are looking at this. So we have our bromonium ion intermediate. And now this is not very happy. This is not a happy situation because that bromine has a positive charge. And so this is actually going to behave a little bit similarly to the case. Remember when we were looking at epoxides and we were running reactions in acidic conditions, we had a specific regiochemistry where any incoming nucleophile was going to go to the more substituted carbon. And the reason is this: in order to try to alleviate that positive charge, we are actually going to start to slightly break one of these bonds. And the thing is that the bond that is more able to dissipate slightly is going to be the one that is attached to the more substituted carbon, because the developing partial positive charge on that intermediate is going to be more stabilized by the additional alkyl group surrounding. And so it is the case that this bond becomes slightly weaker than this bond, and that means that this carbon ends up being more electrophilic. There is a stronger partial plus right here. This is more partially positive than this carbon. And so for precisely that reason, water is going to preferentially attack that carbon. So we may not immediately have guessed that. We may think that any incoming nucleophile is going to go to the less substituted site. But this is an electronic reason. This is not a steric reason. We're looking at electronics here, and we're saying that because of the enhanced partial positivity at this site, water is going to attack here instead. And that is what's going to happen there. And so, again, this is very similar to when we were looking at protonated epoxides. We saw in that case, too, and for the same reasons, that a nucleophile was going to attack the more substituted carbon to pop open that epoxide. And so we're going to get, it's pretty much the same as here, right? We can have, that's actually going to get pushed up, right? That methyl will get pushed up. And we've got the hydroxyl there, and this will remain as a wedge bond there. And so This, again, they're still going to be trans like any halohydrin, but we want to make sure that we understand the regiochemistry here, that the water is going to attack specifically this carbon and not this one in order to pop open that bromonium ion intermediate. And so that's a little bit more information about halohydrin formation. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.